Hey, welcome back everyone to theCUBE's coverage of AWS reInvent 2021 in person. It's a live event, physical in person, also virtual hybrid. So a lot of great action online. Check out the website, all the videos are there on theCUBE as well as what's going on here. But all the action's on site and theCUBE's here. I'm John Furrier, your host with Dave Vellante, my co-host, founder. We got David Brown, VP of Elastic Cloud Compute, Compute Cloud, EC2, known as EC2, the bread and butter, our favorite part of Amazon. David, great to have you back on theCUBE in person.
Well, John, it's great to be back. That's actually the first time I've been on theCUBE in person as well. A lot of virtual events with you guys, but it's amazing to be back at reInvent, yeah.
Terrific. We're so excited for you. I know Matt Garman and I have talked in the past, we've talked in the past. EC2 is just an amazing product. It's always been the core block of AWS. More and more action happening, and developers are now getting more action in there as well. We wrote a big piece about it. What's going on? The silicon's really paying off. You got the also general purpose, Intel and AMD, and you got the custom silicon all working together. What's the new update? Give us the scoop.
Well, John, you know, it's actually 15 years of EC2 this year, and I've been lucky to be on that team for 14 years. And so, you know, incredible to see the growth. It's been an amazing journey. The thing that's really driven us, two things. One is supporting new workloads. And so, you know, what are the workloads that customers have available out there or trying to do on the cloud that we don't support and launch new instance types? And that's the first thing. The second one is price performance. How do we give customers more performance at a continuously decreasing price year over year? And that's just driven innovation across EC2 over the years with things like Graviton, all of our inferential chips, our custom silicon, but also instance types with the latest Intel Ice Lake CPUs, latest Milan, we just announced the Milan, AMD Milan instance. It's just constant innovation across the ever-increasing list of instances. So super exciting.
So instances become the new thing. Provision an instance, spin up an instance. Instance becomes, and you can get instances, flavors, almost like flavors, right?
Yeah.
Take us through the difference between an instance and then the EC2 itself.
That's correct. Yeah, so we actually have, by end of the year, right now we have over 475 different instances available to you. You know, whether it's GPU accelerators, high performance computing instances, memory optimized, just an enormous number. We'll actually hit 500 by the end of the year. But that is it. I mean, you know, customers are looking for different types of machines and those are the instances.
So the custom silicon, you know, it's one of the most interesting developments. We've written about it. AWS's secret weapon is one of them, right?
Yeah.
I wonder if you could take us back to sort of the decision points and the journey. You know, the Annapurna acquisition, you started working with them as a partner, and then you said, all right, let's just buy the company.
Yeah.
and then now you're seeing the acceleration, your time to tape out is way, way compressed.
Yeah.
Maybe, what was the catalyst, and maybe we can get into where it's going.
Yeah, absolutely. Super interesting story, because it actually starts all the way back in 2008. In 2008, EC2 had actually been around for just a little under 2 years. And if you remember back then, everybody was like, well, virtualized and hypervisors, virtualization, would never really get you the same performance as what they were calling bare metal back then, right? As everybody's looking at the cloud. And so we took a look at that, and I mean, network latencies in some cases with hypervisors were as high as 200 or 300 milliseconds. And you know, there were a number of real challenges, and so we knew that we would have to change the way that virtualization works and get into hardware. And so in 2010, 2011, we started to look at how could I offload my network processing, my I/O processing to additional hardware. And that's where we delivered our first Nitro card in 2012 and 2013, where we actually offloaded all of the processing of network to a Nitro card. And that Nitro card actually had an Annapurna ARM chip on it, our Nitro 1 chip.
And for the offload.
The offload card, yeah. And so that's where my team started to code for ARM. We started to work out how Linux works for ARM. We actually had to write our own operating system initially because there weren't any operating systems available we could use. And so that's where we started this journey. And over the years, when we saw how well it worked for networking, we said, let's do it for storage as well. And then we said, hey, we could actually improve security significantly. And by 2017, we'd actually offloaded 100% of everything we did on that server to our offload cards, leaving 100% of the server available for customers. And we're still actually the only cloud provider that does that today.
Just to interject, in the data center today, probably 30% of the general purpose cores are used for offloads. You're saying 0% in the cloud.
On our Nitro instances, so every instance we've launched since 2017, our C5, we use 0% of that central core. And you can actually see that in our instance types. If you look at our largest instance type, you can see that we're giving you 96 cores. Mm-hmm. And we're giving you, in our largest instance, 24 terabytes of memory. We're not giving you 23.6 terabytes, because we need some. It's all given to you as the customer.
So much more efficient.
Much, much more efficient, much better, better price performance as well. But that ultimately, those Nitro chips, we went through Nitro 1, Nitro 2, Nitro 3, Nitro 4, we said, hey, could we build a general purpose way, you know, a server chip? Could we actually bring ARM into the cloud? And in 2018, we launched the A1 instance, which was our Graviton 1 instance. And you know what we didn't tell people at the time is that was actually the same chip we were using on our network card. So essentially, it was a network card that we were giving to you as a server.
I mean, yeah. And,
but what it did is it sparked the ecosystem. That's why we put it out there. And you know, I remember before launch, you were saying, you know, is this just going to be a university project? Are we going to see people from you know big universities using ARM in the cloud? Or is it really going to take off? And the response was amazing. The ecosystem just grew. You know, we had customers move to it and immediately begin to see improvements. And we knew that a year later, Graviton 2 was going to come out. And Graviton 2 was just an amazing chip. It continues to see incredible adoption. 40% price performance improvement over you know, other x86 instances.
This is worth calling out because I think that example, the network card, I mean, innovation can come from anywhere. This is what Jassy always would say is, do the experiments.
Yeah.
But think about the impact of what's going on here, right? You're focused on a mission. Let's get that processing at the lowest cost, pick up some workloads. So you're constantly tinkering and with tuning the engine. New discovery comes in, Nitro is born, the chip comes in. But I think the fundamental thing, and I want to get your reaction to this, because we put this out there on our post on Sunday, and I said, in every inflection point, I'm old enough, my birthday was yesterday, I'm old enough to know that.
I saw that.
I'm old enough to know that in the 80s and all the client server shifts, every inflection point where development changed, the methodology, the mindset or platforms changed, all the apps went to the better platform. Who wants to run their application on a slower platform? Yeah. And so, and those inflections, so now that's happening now, I believe. So you got better performance, and I'm imagining that the app developers are coding for it. Take us through how you see that, because okay, you're offering up great performance for workloads, now it's cloud workloads, that's almost all apps.
Yeah.
Can you comment on that?
Well, it has been really interesting to see. I mean, as I said, we were unsure who was going to use it when we initially launched, and the adoption has been amazing. Initially, obviously, it's always, you know, a lot of the startups, a lot of the more agile companies that can move a lot faster, typically a little bit smaller, they started experimenting, but the data got out there, right? That 40% price performance was a reality. And not only for specific workloads, it was broadly successful across a number of workloads. And so, you know, we actually just had SAP, who obviously is an enormous enterprise, supporting enterprises all over the world, announced that they're going to be moving the S4HANA cloud to run on Graviton 2, which is just phenomenal. And we've seen enterprises of that scale, and game developers, every single vertical, looking to move to Graviton 2 and get that 40% price performance.
Now we have to, as analysts, we have to say, okay, how did you get to that 40%? And you have to make some assumptions, obviously.
Yeah.
And it feels like you still have some dry powder when you look at, when you looked at Graviton 2, I think you were running it, I don't know if this, it's speculated anyway, I don't know if you guys, it's your data, 2.5, you know, 2.5 gigahertz.
Yeah.
I don't know if we can share what's going on with Graviton 3, but my point is you had some dry powder, and now you have, with Graviton 3, quite a range of performance, because it really depends on the workload.
That's right.
Maybe you could give some insight as to that. So and what can you share about how you tuned Graviton 3?
When we look at benchmarking, you know, we don't want to be trying to find that benchmark that's highly tuned and then put out something that is, you know, hey, this is the absolute best we could get it to, and that's 40%. So that 40% is actually just on average. So we just went and ran real world workloads, and we saw some that were 55%, we saw some that were 25, you know, depending on what it was, but on average it was around the 35-45%, and we said 40%. And the great thing about that is customers come back and say, hey, we saw 40% in this workload, it wasn't that I had to tune it. And so with Graviton 3, you know, launching this week, available in our C7G instance, we said 25%. And that is just a very standard benchmark in what we're seeing. And as, you know, as we start to see more customer workloads, I think it's going to be incredible to see what that range looks like. Graviton 2, for single-threaded applications, it didn't give you that much of a performance boost. It was more, that's what we meant by cloud applications, which are normally multi-threaded. In Graviton 3, that's no longer the case. So, you know, we've had some customers report up to 80% performance improvement of Graviton 2 to Graviton 3 when the application was more of a single-threaded application. So, we started to see.
So, the other key point
about the single-threaded. The other key point I want to add is the time to market is compressing, right? So, you have that. Go ahead, sorry.
I just want to add one thing about the difference between single and multi-threaded applications. A lot of legacy are single-threaded, so this is kind of an interesting thing. We saw the mainframe migration stuff, you're starting to see that. Is that where that comes in, the whole?
Well, a lot of the legacy apps, but also even some of the newer apps, right? If single threading in like video transcoding, for example, is all done on a single core. It's very difficult, I mean, almost impossible to do that multi-threaded way. A lot of the crypto algorithms as well, encryption and cryptography is often single core. So with Graviton 3, we've seen a significant performance boost for, you know, video encoding, cryptographic algorithms, that sort of thing, which really impacts even the most modern applications.
So that's an interesting point, because now single-threaded is where the vertical use cases come in. It's not like more general purpose OS kind of thing. things.
Yeah, and Graviton's already been very broad. I think we're just knocking down the last few verticals where, you know, maybe it didn't support it, and now it absolutely does.
And if an ISV then ports, like an SAP ports to Graviton, then the customer doesn't see any, I mean, they're going to see the performance difference, but they don't have to think about it.
Yeah.
Right? They just say, I choose that instance, and I'm going to get better
exactly.
price performance.
Exactly, so that's what, yeah. We've seen that from our ISVs. We've also been doing that with our AWS services. So, you know, services like EMR, RDS, ElastiCache have all been moving and making Graviton2 available for customers, which means the customer doesn't have to do the migration at all. It's all done for them. They just pick the instance and get the price performance benefit.
That was serverless. Sorry.
Lambda actually just did launch on Graviton2, and I think they were talking about a 35% price performance improvement.
Who was that? Sorry.
Lambda. A couple of months ago.
So what does an ISV have to do to port to Graviton?
Yeah, it's relatively straightforward. And this is actually one of the things that has slowed customers down, is the, wow, that must be a big migration, right? And that ecosystem that I spoke about is the important part. And today, you know, with all the Linux operating systems being available for ARM, running on Graviton2, with all of the container runtimes being available, and then just all the open source applications and ISVs being available, it's actually really, really easy. And we just ran the Graviton 4-day challenge, and we did that because we actually had an enterprise migrate one of their largest production applications in just 4 days. Now, I probably wouldn't recommend that to most enterprises, obviously it's a little too fast, but they could actually do that.
Just from a number standpoint, that's insanely amazing. I mean, when you think about 4 days.
Yeah.
And when we talked virtually, last year, this year, I can't remember now, you said, well, just try it.
That's right.
See what happens. So that's I presume a lot of people have tried it.
Well, that's my advice. You know, it's the unknown. It's the what will it take. So take a single engineer, tell them, you know, give them a time. Say you have 1 week, get this running on Graviton2. And I think the results are pretty amazing. Very surprising.
You know, we were one of the first, if not the first, to say that ARM is going to be dominant in the enterprise. We know it's dominant in the edge.
Yeah.
And when you look at the performance curves and the time to tape out, it's just, it's astounding. And I don't know if people appreciate that relative to the traditional Moore's Law curve. Yeah. I mean, it's astounding. And when you combine the power of the CPU, the GPU, the NPU, kind of what Apple does in the iPhone, it blows away the historical performance curves. And you're on that curve. I wonder if you could sort of explain that to folks.
So with Graviton, you know, we're optimizing just across every single part of AWS. And one of the nice things is we actually own that end to end. So when it starts with the early design of Graviton2 and Graviton3, and we're obviously working on other chips right now, we're actually using the cloud to do all of the electronic design automation. So we're able to test with AWS how that Graviton3 chip's going to work long before we've even started taping it out. And so those workloads are running on high frequency CPUs on Graviton, actually. We're using Graviton to build Graviton now in the cloud. The other thing we're doing is we're making sure that the Annapurna team that's building those CPUs is deeply engaged with my team who are going to ultimately go and build those instances so that when that chip arrives from tape out, I'm not waiting 9 months or 2 years like would normally be the case, but I'm actually, I have an instance up and running within a week or two on somebody's desk starting to do the integration. And that's something we've optimized significantly to get down. And so it allows us to get that iteration time. It also allows us to be very, very accurate with our tape outs. We're not having to go back with Graviton, they're all A1 chips. We're not having to go back and do multiple runs of these things because we can do so much validation and performance testing in the cloud ahead of time.
This is the epiphany of the ARM model.
It really is.
It's a standard. When you send it to the fab, they know it's going to work, right? And you hit volume and it's just it's amazing.
Well, this is a great thread. We'll stay on this because Adam told us when we met with him for reInvent that they're seeing a lot more visibility into use cases at the scale. Mm-hmm. So the scale gives you an advantage on what instances might work.
It makes the economics work,
hence the timing, the shrinking time to market. Not there, but also for the apps. Talk about the scale advantage you guys have.
Oh, absolutely. I mean, the scale advantage of AWS plays out in a number of ways for our customers, right? The first thing is being able to deliver highly optimized hardware. So, you know, we don't just look at the Graviton 3 CPU, you were speaking about the core count and the frequency, and Peter spoke about a lot of that in his keynote yesterday. But we look at how does the Graviton 3 CPU work with the rest of the instance? What is the right balance between the CPU and memory, the CPU and the hard drive? Right. What's the performance on the drive? We just launched the Nitro SSD, which is now we're building our own custom SSDs for Nitro, getting better performance, being able to do updates, better security, making it more cloudy, which is something we've been challenged with SSD in the past. The other place that scale's really helping is in capacity. Being able to make sure that we can absorb things like the COVID spike, right? Or, you know, the stuff we've seen in the financial industry with just enormous demand for compute, we can do that because of our scale. We are able to scale. And the final area is actually in quality. Because I have such an enormous fleet, I'm actually able to drive down AFR, so annual failure rates, and we're well below what the mathematical, theoretical tenet or possibility is. So if you look at what's put on that actual sticker on the box that says you should be able to get a 4% AFR, at scale and with focus, we're actually able to get that down to significantly below what the mathematical entitlement would actually be.
Yeah, it's incredible. What a great, and this is the advantage, and that's why I believe anyone who's writing applications that includes a database, data transfer, any kind of execution of code will use the stack.
Why wouldn't they?
Why
no,
wouldn't they?
Really, why, if you're, we've seen this, like you said before, whether it was PC, then the fastest Pentium, or somebody
why would you want your app to run slower?
On a Unix box, right.
I mean, what?
ISVs want it to run as fast and as cheaply as possible, and now power plays into it as well.
Yeah. Right. Well, we do have, I mean, I agree with what you're saying. We do have a number of customers that are still looking to run on x86. Obviously, customers that run Windows. Windows isn't available for ARM, and so that's a challenge. They'll continue to do that. And you know, the way we do look at it is Moore's Law kind of died out on us in 2002, 2003. Right. And what I'm hoping is, not necessarily bringing Moore's Law back, but then we say, you know, let's not accept a 10%, 15% improvement year over year. There's absolutely more we can all be doing. And so I'm excited to see, yep, you know, where the x86 world's going. I know they're doing a lot of great stuff. Intel iStack's looking amazing. Milan is really great to have on AWS as well.
Well, I mean, I think it's a fair point, because you look what Pat's doing at Intel, and he's remaking the company. I mean, I've said he's kind of following the ARM playbook in my mind a little bit, and which is the right thing to do. So,
well,
you know, competition is a good thing.
Absolutely, yeah.
We're excited for you, and it's great to see Graviton, and you guys have this kind of inflection point. We've been, you know, tracking for a while, but now the world's starting to see it. So congratulations to you and the team.
Thank you.
Just on couple other things, you guys have some news on instances. Talk about the deprecation issue and how you guys are keeping instances alive real quick. Give the plug.
Yeah, you know, we're super customer obsessed at Amazon, and something that really drives us. And one of the worst things for us to do is to have to tell a customer that we're no longer supporting a service. You know, we recently actually just deprecated the EC2 Classic network. I'm not sure if you saw that. And that's actually after 10 years of continuing to support it. And the only reason we did it is we have a tiny percentage of customers still using that from back in, you know, 2012. But one of the challenges is obviously instance hardware eventually will ultimately time out and fail and, you know, have hardware issues as it gets older and older. And so we didn't want to be in a place in EC2 where we would have to constantly go to customers and say, that M1 small, that C3, whatever you were running, it's no longer supported, please move. That's just a tax that customers shouldn't have to do, and if they're still getting value out of an older instance, let them keep using it. So we actually just announced at reInvent in my keynote on Tuesday, the longevity support for EC2 instances, which means we'll never come back to you again and ask you to please get off an instance, because we can actually emulate all those instances on our Nitro system. And so all of these instances are starting to migrate to Nitro. You're getting all the benefits of Nitro for now some of our older Xen instances, but also you don't have to worry about that work that's just not something you need to do to get off an older instance.
That's great. That's a great service. Hey, stay on as long as you want.
Yeah.
When you're ready to move, move. Okay, final question for you. I know we got time, so I want to get this in. The global network you guys are known for, AWS Cloud WAN service.
Yeah.
Give us the update on what's going on with that.
So Vernick just announced that in his keynote. And you know, over the last 2 to 3 years or so, we've seen a lot of customers starting to use the AWS backbone, which is extensive. I mean, you've seen the slides in Vernick's keynote. It really does span the world. I think it's probably one of the largest networks out there. Customers starting to use that for actually their branch office communication. So instead of going and, you know, provisioning their own, you know, international MPLS networks and that sort of thing, they say, let me onboard to AWS with VPN or Direct Connect, and I can actually run the AWS backbone around the world. Now, doing that actually has some complexity. You've got to think about transit gateways, you've got to think about those inter-region peering, and AWS Cloud WAN takes all of that complexity away. You essentially create a Cloud WAN, connect into it with VPN or Direct Connect, and you can even go and actually set up network segments, so essentially VLANs, for different parts of your organization. So super excited to get that out there. I think we
see the ease of use is the key there.
Massively easy to use. And we have, you know, 26 SD-WAN partners. We're even partnering with folks like Verizon and Swisscom in Switzerland, the telco, to actually allow them to use it for their customers as well.
And the other one was user service someday when we have a global rollout day.
Yeah, let's do that. Yeah, the Cube Global. And then the other one was the M1 EC2 instance, which got a lot
of
applause.
Absolutely, absolutely.
Right? Yeah, I think it's based on A15, which is
the Mac. We've got to be careful because M1 is our first instance as well.
Yeah, so, yeah, right. There's a little confusion there. Right?
So it's the Mac, the EC2 Mac instance with the M1 silicon from Apple, which we're super excited to put out there.
Awesome.
David Brown, great to see you in person. Congratulations to you and the team and all the work you guys have done over the years. And now that people are starting to realize the cloud platform, the compute just gets better and better, It's a key part of the system.
Thanks John. It's great
sharing.
To be here.
Thanks for sharing. The SiliconANGLE is here. We're talking about custom silicon here on AWS. I'm John Furrier, David Lott. You're watching theCUBE, the global leader in tech coverage. We'll be right back with more coverage from reInvent after this break.